Would it surprise you if I said that monsters are some of my favorite art in role-playing games? Today, let's talk about my top 10 pieces of RPG artwork on this episode of The Local Disaster Tour Guide. Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Mark, and I am the Local Disaster Tour Guide. That's right, I'm your average everyday storyteller who desperately needs some fan art of my latest TPK. Welcome to my channel where we talk about role-playing games like Pathfinder and Starfinder. Today, I am testing out some new equipment and doing a little bit of a silly top 10 list. I want to talk about my favorite RPG artwork from various systems that I've just taken notice of over the years. Before I get going, I want to do a quick shout out to my buddy Mike, who helped me get some new equipment and kind of test out this setup. So hopefully this works out well for the channel. Mike, thank you very much. I appreciate your help. The inspiration for this video actually came from a previous video that I did. When I was reviewing the Pathfinder 2nd Edition Bestiary, I commented on the artwork and I mentioned that artwork is something that it's usually something that I miss in role-playing games. Like, I know it's there, I appreciate the work that artists do, but it's not something that I really focus on. Well, that comment kind of got my head spinning and made me ask the question, what artwork has stuck with me over the years? And so I really sat down and started to think, what are some of my favorite examples of RPG artwork, and what has really left an impression on me? So today, I'm going to be doing my top 10 list of my favorite pieces of artwork from RPGs. Now, really quick, I'm going to do my best to give a proper credit to the source game, to the original artist. I'm going to try to say when pieces of art were published. I'm going to try to do a full credit because I know that there is a lot of work that goes into art. However, up front, let me just say that if I get a source wrong or if I credit the wrong artist, please don't get mad at me. I tried to do my best research on this, but some of these pieces of art were hard to hunt down, and I'm even going to say that there were several pieces of artwork where I wasn't able to confirm who the artist actually was. So if I get anything wrong in this video, please leave me a comment, let me know. I would love to make sure that the proper people are getting credit for the excellent work that they do. But still, I have done my best to try to make sure that I am giving credit where credit is due, and this is my top 10 favorite pieces of RPG artwork ever. So first, let me throw out an honorable mention. If you saw my Bestiary review video, you saw this picture already, and that is the Gogoteth from Pathfinder 2nd Edition. This was published in their first Bestiary in 2019, and if you saw that video, you know the reason that this particular piece of art stands out to me, and that's simply because this piece of art is basically every nightmare that I have ever had combined into one terrifying image. Now, I will go ahead and say that after some research, I was not able to confirm who the actual artist for this image is, and I have decided to accept that no human being actually drew this because I would be terrified of the mind that could conceive of such a creature. So instead, I have decided that the Gogoteth clearly was drawn by Cthulhu, who is moonlighting at Paizo Publishing. But that's my honorable mention. Let's move on to the list itself. So at number 10, we have the weapon sketches from Dungeons & Dragons 3.5 that come from the Player's Handbook. These were done by Lars Grant West, and they were published in July of 2003. Now, I do want to say real quick that I'm not exactly sure if the initial appearance of this sketch was D&D 3.5. I think these sketches may have actually appeared in Dungeons & Dragons 3.0. And if somebody knows for sure where these sketches originally started, if that's the case, please throw a comment down below. But I do know these appeared in the 3.5 edition Player's Handbook. And I have to say, this may have been the most surprising entry on the list for me, but when I sat down and thought about it, These sketches are my favorite sketches of weapons in any role-playing book that I've ever seen. You know, weapon sketches are something that you get in a lot of role-playing games, but there's something about these simple drawings that have stuck with me in a way that other weapon illustrations haven't in other games and other editions of this game. And for me, I think what makes this particular piece of artwork stand out is the sense of scale that Lars Grant West put into these illustrations. By putting all of these weapons side by side, and by putting that grid into the background of this illustration, it really gives a better sense of how these weapons compare to one another and how these weapons might be utilized on the battlefield. It's a very simple thing, but this is definitely an illustration that has stuck with me. So at number 10, the D&D 3.5 weapon sketches, I just think that these are fantastic illustrations. So for number 9, I'm going to talk about a particularly famous piece of iconic artwork, and that is Lita Discovers the Dangers of Use Magic Device, again from Dungeons & Dragons 3.5 and the Player's Handbook. This was published in July of 2003, and the artist for this particular piece was John Foster. An iconic character is when a role-playing game chooses to create a specific character which they use to represent an element inside of the game. In this case, Lita was the iconic rogue for D&D 3.5. And I'm going to say that D&D 3.5 may have had some of the best iconic humor in terms of how the characters were used in their books. Lita and the Dangers of Use Magic Device narrowly beat out Jozan Aids Krusk in a climb check. You should look that one up because it's pretty good too. But this particular piece of artwork may be one of the most referenced pieces of artwork in my gaming group. Something about this comic, small but notable explosion has really stuck in the minds of my players, and it stuck out in my mind too, so I have to give credit where credit is due. Lita gets a spot on this list. So at number 8, we have a much more recent piece of artwork. This actually comes from 2020, and it's Shellen's Stained Glass Window from Lost Omens Gods and Magic. This was put out by Paizo Publishing, and I'm going to go ahead and say I don't know who the actual artist is on this piece of art. Real quick, anytime Paizo shows up on this list, I've had a really hard time attributing specific pieces of Paizo art to specific artists. They do list their contributing artists in the books, but it's often very difficult to say which artist did which particular work, and that's the case here. But Lost Omens Gods and Magic did something really unique and something I really enjoyed as a way of expressing the flavor of their campaign setting. For each of the deities discussed in that setting book, one of the things that they included was real-world art. They wanted to show how worshippers inside the Galarian setting might portray their particular deity, and I thought that was a really creative inclusion. They might have idols or tapestries or paintings, or in the case of the Church of Shellen, a stained glass window. Now, my wife and I are huge fans of stained glass windows, and we would really like to put a stained glass window in this house one day. So that definitely gave this particular piece of art a leg up for me. But I think this is a fantastic way to show some in-world flavor for the Galarian campaign setting. So number 8, Shellen's Stained Glass Window. For number 7 on this list, I wanted to include something from White Wolf Publishing. I've mentioned in other videos that White Wolf Publishing is one of the companies that had a big influence on me as I was developing as a gamer. And I kicked around different samples of artwork from White Wolf. I thought about several different options from Exalted, for example, but at the end of the day, there was definitely a piece of artwork that stood head and shoulders above the rest when it comes to the different things that White Wolf Publishing has put out, and that is the Ravnos Clan Book cover art from Vampire the Masquerade, published in 2001. The artist for this particular piece of work is John Van Fleet, and I'm pretty sure that this comes from the 3rd edition version of Vampire the Masquerade, but if I got that wrong, please somebody let me know in the comments. Basically, when it comes to this particular piece of art, there's only one thing that I can't figure out. Is this piece of art the perfect illustration for the chaotic neutral alignment, or is it the perfect illustration for the charisma stat? I don't know for sure. I do know you probably shouldn't let this person in your party, but I also know you probably will, and the stories will be amazing. So, number 7, the Ravnos Clan book cover art. I think that this is a fantastic piece of work. For number 6, I kicked back and forth between a couple of different options here as well. I was considering using some artwork from the old Ravenloft setting, which is a setting that I really, really enjoy from classic D&D. And I was also considering the game Shadowrun, because there's just some really iconic and entertaining artwork from that particular game. I went back and forth for a little while, but eventually I settled on an illustration that one of my players lovingly refers to as Snoop Elf. Now, this particular picture is actually pulled from the Shadowrun Crossfire game, but I can tell you that this picture was published in Shadowrun 5th Edition's core rulebook, which was published in 2013. Much like with Paizo Publishing, when it comes to Shadowrun, it's very hard for me to give credit to a particular artist. I don't know exactly who made this piece of art, but I think this is a good illustration of why Shadowrun's art sticks out to me. I love Shadowrun's art because it is this wonderful mix of this very dark and gritty and just depressing world with these garish, bright neon colors. And the contrast between those two elements is something that's always stuck out to me in those games. It's something I've always enjoyed. And while there are very few pieces of Shadowrun art that just jump out as major pieces of art, the consistent tone of those pieces of art is definitely something that has stuck with me. This particular character is one of my gaming group's favorites. As I've said, he's been lovingly nicknamed Snoop Elf, and I think he is a great stand-in for Shadowrun and the art that they use. So, number 6 on the list, Snoop Elf. So for number 5 on this list, we're going to go with, again, a very new piece of art. And this comes from Paizo Publishing, and it's called Variant Ezrans. This comes from the Game Mastery Guide, which was published this year in 2020. And this particular piece of art is actually full-page artwork that is included at the start of the Variant Rules chapter found in the Game Mastery Guide. In this particular piece of art, you have their iconic wizard, Ezran, who has stumbled into an art gallery containing multiple different alternate versions of himself. And part of the reason I like this particular piece of art is this totally inspires a game session I'm going to throw at my party one day. I would love to see the look on their faces as they walk into a room and see so many different versions of themselves hanging on the wall. And you know that is a precursor to an amazing fight scene. I think this is a very interesting and flavorful piece. Good job, Paizo. Variant Ezrans, number 5. So for number 4 on the list, I actually want to share my favorite iconic character of all time. And I'm happy to include this on the list as well, because it is a fantastic piece of art from the game Starfinder. This is the half-elf iconic character from Starfinder's core rulebook, published in 2017. Now, I feel like this is a really good example of maybe the operative or envoy class in that game. I don't know which class exactly is being represented here, but I will tell you one of the big reasons that this particular piece of art jumps out to me, and that is, this is hands down my favorite take on an invisibility cloak ever in any game. I love how this is illustrated, and it really just elevates this picture to a higher level for me. I also have to say, I feel like this character could rival the Ravnos Clan book cover art for extreme levels of confidence and charisma. So this is an easy number 4 for me. This is definitely my hands-down favorite piece of iconic character artwork from an RPG, the Half-Elf from Starfinder's core rulebook. But now we come to my top 3. And I'm going to say the top 3 on this list are definitely standouts compared to everything else that I've included. When I was trying to create this list, I knew my top three instantly. The other items on this list I had to think about for a little bit to really decide what I wanted, but I knew my top three. And starting at number three, I want to share Santa in the Alley. This comes from the D20 Modern Core Rulebook published in 2002, and I am not 100% sure about the artist for this particular piece. I believe this was created by Dean Ormstrom. If I got that wrong, please let me know. I would love to give proper credit to the artist who did this, because this may be the most shocking piece of RPG artwork I have ever seen. I remember flipping past this particular piece of art several times as I was reading through the D20 Modern Core Rulebook, and I knew that it was a depiction of someone being killed in an alleyway. And I just kind of glossed over the photo. But then one day, I was flipping through the book, and I stopped, and I turned back, and I took a closer look, and I realized someone took out Santa. It was just this glorious moment of shock, and bravo to the artist who came up with this concept. This is a piece of art that you could easily skip over, but when you take the time to look at it, the story that plays out in your mind is phenomenal. This would be a really, really entertaining, like, fantasy modern story to tell. And I have to give it number three on my list, Santa Dead in an Alley. So that brings us to the number two piece of art on my list. And I've mentioned before about the concept of iconic characters, and those are wonderful, but I do have to give another shout out to D20 Modern for actually illustrating me. Yes, that's right. Number two on my list is the Mind Flayer Priest from D20 Modern's Core Rulebook, again published in 2002. The artist for this is Ryan Suk, and let me just say, I love this artwork. Anybody who knows me knows that Mind Flayers are my all-time favorite monster in Dungeons & Dragons. I love running encounters with Mind Flayers. They are one of my favorite elements to include in a story. So, with D20 Modern, when they began to imagine fantasy monsters in a modern world, this was hands down my favorite take. They put my favorite monster in what is essentially my real world career path. I work as a chaplain, so this is me. Now, I know that sounds silly, but I actually used this piece of artwork to inspire an annual tradition for my gaming group. Every year on my birthday, my players have to take down the Dungeon Master. And every year, they find themselves battling a Mind Flayer in a priest outfit. I love this artwork. It spawned one of the most entertaining traditions at my gaming table. Ryan Suk, fantastic work. I think that this is an excellent addition, and this is easily number two on my list, the Mind Flayer Priest. So that brings us to the number one all-time favorite piece of RPG artwork, at least for me personally, and it probably shouldn't surprise you that it's going to be a monster. I'm a storyteller, I like throwing monsters at my players, and when I see a monster that captures my interest, you know that I plan on using that thing. And my all-time favorite monster actually comes from the Manual of the Planes in Dungeons & Dragons 3.0. Not 3.5, 3.0. This is easily the oldest piece of artwork on my list. That is the Axiomatic Bullet, or, as it's also known, the Perfect Land Shark. This particular piece of art was done by Matt Cavada and was published in 2001. I mentioned a moment ago that the Mind Flayer is one of my all-time favorite monsters. Well, the Bullet may not be my number one monster of all time, but it is definitely in the top five. I love the Land Shark, and I love throwing these things at an unprepared party. I've gotten more than a few player kills off of Bullets. And when I saw the Axiomatic Bullet published in the Manual of the Planes, I instantly fell in love with this illustration. These creatures have shown up in multiple games that I have run, and this is a creature that has traveled from edition to edition to edition because of how much this picture just gets my mind spinning. Quick note, One of the things you should know about axiomatic bullets, these are pack hunters. Yeah. Imagine how terrifying it is to have more than one of these chasing you down. So this is easily my favorite piece of art that's ever been published in an RPG. So that's my list, but let me throw it back out to you guys. What are some of your favorite illustrations from various RPG games throughout the year? What are the pieces of art or the artists that have really stuck out to you, and who are some of the unsung heroes of the genre in your mind? Leave a comment down below with some of your favorite pieces of art and some of your favorite artists. Although, quick note, please keep it PG-13 or better. But definitely take some time to give a shout out to the people who have inspired you throughout your gaming career. If you enjoyed this video, like it and share it. Subscribe to our channel. Hopefully this new technology is going to allow me to improve the kinds of videos I can do and some of the things that I can offer through this channel. This has been a fun experiment, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Have a wonderful day. Hello everyone, this is Mark with the post-credits volunteer shout-out. And I know that this may be a little bit early to be talking about this again, but I did want to share this with you guys because I'm excited that I was able to do this. I was actually able to donate blood today. I've mentioned this several times on my channel. Donating blood is a fantastic way to literally save lives, and just about anybody can do it. It takes about 20 to 25 minutes, and you can very easily help people who are in critical need by becoming a blood donor. Years ago, I was terrified of needles. I still am, honestly. But I knew that I needed to face that fear. So I made the decision that I was going to donate blood once, specifically once, as a way of stating that my fears would not control me. So I went down to the blood center, and I donated blood for the first time. And I remember my best friend, who was with me, now my wife, saying, "Mark, you know if you're the universal donor, you have to keep doing this." I don't know if I've ever forgiven her for saying that, but I do know that I appreciate the fact that I have been able to donate blood regularly now for 11 years. Today, I actually asked the phlebotomist at the blood donation center if I could get a record of my blood donation. And when they printed out my records, I actually found out that I have donated almost 6 gallons of blood over the course of the last 11 years. That amazed me. If you are terrified to donate blood, believe me, I understand that fear. I had to overcome fears myself. But it's quick, it's easy. The people who run that center, they are professionals. And this is a fantastic way that you can help people in need. Again, I know that I've mentioned blood donation recently, but I am excited that I finally figured out what was wrong with my iron and got it up again so that I could start donating again. So it's something of a victory for me today. I wanted to share it with you. I'm happy to be doing it again, and I would like to encourage you, if you've never donated blood, maybe now's the time to give it a shot. In any case, look for opportunities to be a blessing to your community, and have a wonderful day.